Hello everyone. I see that a lot of people came here. It's good, actually. I'm really happy to it. Thank you. My name is Mateusz Pusz. I'm working for C++ for many years right now. I worked at Intel for 13 years. I right now work at EPAM Systems. And also I have my own company called Trinity, where I do the consulting and training for the engineers in Poland and in Europe. So you are invited to invite me to your site, if you like, at some point. And basically what I do when I share my knowledge with others, I share the knowledge that I gained with heart and many hours of time that I put in efforts like learning CMake or Conan, which is not that easy to learn. Can I have like show of hands how many of you like CMake actually? And how many of you use CMake? Yeah, as I expected, no one likes it and nearly all use it. So yeah, this is the case that's pretty typical to the environment we have here. It turns out that CMake is a really old project and it evolved during the time, but we somehow miss it. There is something so-called modern CMake, and using modern CMake makes it much more friendlier, if we can say friendly about CMake. But it will be much easier. I will show you some hints of it, but we don't have time to cover everything about modern CMake. But we'll see how it works. I would like to scope today only on things, how to ship and reuse our C++ project. So I'll scope on dependency handling, on installing stuff on our machines, and so on. I will not tell you how to write a function or macro in CMake in a modern way. Okay. So basically, talking about our toolset for C++, it seems that we have already standardized a bit our environment. It seems that most of the projects use Git, and most of the projects use CMake. For packet management, unfortunately, we have none of them. I think that's a good state, that we have something standardized, maybe that is not too well loved by all of us, like CMake, but we are using it because it's popular, because it's becoming a standard here. When I tried to submit the same talk on the ACCU, I got the feedback that I should rather, instead of Git, be talking about the Mercurial because it's better, and instead of CMake, I should talk about, remember what it was? Something M starting, thing. Excuse me? M. Also M, yeah. I don't remember exactly what was this build system, but it was also claimed to be better. No make files. I don't think that's a good idea to try to find a bit better things in one place, maybe worse in other place, just to make our environment once again differentiated into many other tools. It's good that we have standardized it a bit, and I hope that Conan, or maybe some other package manager, will become a standard soon. I'll talk about the Conan because I think it's the strongest contender right now to become a standard environment for us. Yeah, but first let's talk about the typical ways to handle dependencies in C++ projects. How many of you use external or third-party subdirectory in your project to handle dependencies? Like 10%, 20? Don't be shy. Yeah. How many of you decided that copy-pasting source code is not fine, so you're using Git submodules for that? Yeah, another 10% or 15. And how many of you actually download each dependency and install it on your drive or system? Only if, no, 10% again. Okay, so it seems that either we are not using the things, or I see that there are persons that are raising their hand all the time, like Odin here, and he says, depending on the project. Yeah, I totally agree. Okay, did you ever use some other languages toolsets, like Maven, to do it? No. Oh, one hand here. And did you ever use Conan? Do you have any experience with that? Odin again. Wow. So you're using everything. And you know Conan already, and you are still using the first ones?
Yeah.
Shame on you. Okay, so what I try to say here is that the first two bullets are wrong, and you should stop doing it. Why? Let's assume that this is our dependency tree of our libA, By that I mean that the private dependency, so it's only used for internal unit testing. By this I mean that this is a public dependency, and what's even more, it aggregates into the libA and is provided to the users. Like for example, let's say file system boost file system path in arguments of the libA. Yes, so it affects the user of us, of our library. And now assume we have two of those. One of them is using boost 166, one of them is the older one, so it's using boost 157 because this is how submodules were created. Also different version of gtest. This one also has OpenSSL. And now we have another project that just uses both of them. And look how your Git tree and your file tree start to explode. And if you want to compile up, you compile this boost and OpenSSLs and gtest. And what even more is more tricky here is that, for example, libA and libB provide you the same header of two different library versions. Are you sure they are compatible with each other? Or OpenSSL here, for example, shared library for handling the secure stuff that you intend to have secure. Which OpenSSL is linked to the application? Which engine? The latest one, the secure one, or maybe the older one? This is how we handle dependencies right now. And this is only like two layers of dependencies. They are projects that have like 10 layers of dependencies. And it's a huge tree. You wouldn't like to have like 10 different versions of boost or even the same boost put in the same file tree just by doing submodules or copy-pasting the sources to third-party directory. You would like to have it once and the version exactly you care for. And this is why add subdirectory in CMake and having them in subdirectories either with Git submodule or just copy-pasting sources doesn't scale. Think about others. Don't think that your project is the last one in the pipeline that will be using this thing. Someone will use your project later on and it will use all your dependencies. And it will have its own dependencies too. So let's talk about the CMake. CMake is not a build system. It's a cross-platform C++ build generator. It handles different systems like makefiles, like Windows subsystems, Visual Studio, and so on. So right now we'll scope on GCC and Visual Studio because those are the most common cases here. But of course you can add Clang here and so on, but this is basically the first case. So this is how you work with CMake. You just create some subdirectory build probably, go into it, and then you are doing CMake like build release, because we are talking about the installation stuff. We want to release to install mostly the release versions. And then we provide the install prefix where we want to install the stuff, and we are configuring the project with release build type provided during the configuration step. Then we are doing build, we use some unit testing, and then we install it. All with CMake, we don't have to touch any makefile commands here. The same for Visual Studio. We are using the generator for Visual Studio 2017. We are doing install prefix, but note that release or debug version is not provided during configuration step, but during build and run and installation step. During configuration step, Visual Studio doesn't care about your release or debug stuff. This is really important to remember. Talking about the modern CMake, it's everything that's after CMake 2.8.12. According to Daniel Pfeiffer, I really recommend you, if you're working with CMake, to watch that video of him from C++ Now a year ago. It was probably voted as the best workshop on this conference, taking 5 days. So it's really, really good, and you should work it, view it, and try to use it in your projects. I have some information from it here, but not all. Basically, build flags don't scale. Modern CMake is about targets. And you should use targets if you're using flags, like you're playing with CXX flags, or you're using include directories or add defines. You shouldn't do it. Every change in the public flags has to be propagated upwards. It's not possible to maintain flags at a large scale, and different projects may require different flag settings. For example, let's assume that one of the projects has a unique name of a verbose tag provided during the compilation. Another also has the same unique name of verbose defined in the project, but one is like three layers from 0 to 2, let's say, 0, 1, and 2 verbosity levels, and the one is from 1 to 5. How would you like to configure both of these projects that are happen to be dependency of your project with the same flag, but having different values in it, yes? Things like undefined provided globally for all the CMake, and then you cannot specialize. This target should use from 0 to 2, and this one should from 1 to 5. And verbose seems to be quite a good tag here. And it seems that many of the names conflict, because we tend to use the same names. We never say, this is lib A verbose, lib B verbose, when we are providing flags to our projects. What I mean by targets? We can create executables and libraries with this interface. There is add executable to create executables, and there is add library with shared tag to have shared library, to have a static library, to have an object library for macOS and some similar stuff. Interface, for example, for header-only libraries. And also there is possibility to create an alias for another of those. And some of them, like shared static, config, and interface, can be also marked as imported or imported global. It means that they are just compiled on your hard disk, like you have library created by someone else, for example, and you want to use it as in CMake as a target. So basically CMake will not compile it, it just assumes that it's already compiled and this is a binary for it. If you will not provide static or shared, it will be determined based on build shared libs CMake variable, if it's on or off. So you have the possibility to configure it either to have the shared or static version of the libraries. Modern CMake is basically about the targets, and targets allow us the modular design, which is really, really good because it's easy to have dependencies between targets being tracked. Right now I'm in the refactoring of a big project in my company that was using old style CMake, like every CMake file, there were like 360 CMake files in this project. And all of them were using like include directories, add defines, target link libraries with specific library provided each time. And if there was a, let's say, for example, I needed a boost somewhere in the utilities, let's say boost thread, then I had to provide this header path in includes to every, static library that was linking that one, utilities, then it was system, then it was something like a parser, then it was like engine using that parser. Every one of them has to provide the same path every time to include directories in order to make this project compile. It doesn't scale, and moreover, when I created a graph from CMake, there is possible to create a graph with a graph of CMake dependencies. It was like spider nets that all of the nodes were connected to each other, because everyone depended on everything, and it was really hard to find a large-scale design of this application that has 300 CMake files. With targets, it's much easier, because you have a target and you provide the properties for it. You say this target is has a linking privately, publicly, or is this only an interface, linking with some other target. And what it means that if I need something to compile, and my clients will need something to compile, that's a public dependency. If only I need something to compile, like gtest, for example, for my test, but my clients will never use it, that's private. Sometimes it's that I don't use something for compilation because, for example, I am header-only library, but my clients would need a path to my library, then it's an interface. No, and in the case if I do not need anything and my clients do not need anything, then yeah, you have a lunch. And the most important part here is that interface and public dependencies are transitive. What I mean by that is that if you will link here publicly or interface with some other targets, public stuff of this stuff will become public stuff of your target. So basically you provided this include path to boost thread only once. If you linked with OpenSSL somewhere, you provided only once as a public dependency. And every time then you will be linking with those or their childs, let's say, in dependency tree, you will just transitively get their properties. it really scales and then really nicely works. And if you print a graph of such stuff, it looks really, really nice. And you see exactly what depends on what and in how what manner. Alias targets are special targets that mimic those namespace :: library name style that you can know, for example, if you ever linked with gtest or other stuff. It was always like you had to provide gtest :: gtest or something like this. This is because of find package works like this and provides such an interface. So basically, if you would like, for example, our my library that we have here ever work with find package, it will most probably return you my companion, my library here to LinkedIn. And if you would like to once link in with things find by find package, sometimes other by library created in the same file, it's better to have unique name to just use alias my companion my library for my library. Then you can have only one linking code later on. And you don't care if it was found by find package or it was created somewhere else but by some other CMake file earlier. Otherwise, you would have to have some if branch here. Moreover, having this namespace stuff here makes it more safe because the reminder of this has to be a target. It doesn't have to be something not defined, so basically you cannot provide the typos. If you want to link with something but you will provide a typo, it will just assume that's a variable that's not defined yet, and so it's empty, so it will not do anything. If you will have a typo here to say there is no target called main or some other different word. So it's safer. One of the most complex stuff of the CMake are the generated expressions. This is the syntax of how we write them, and their usage, and they are used and useful because most of the CMake file is parsed during so-called disconfiguration step by the command interpreter, but those are parsed during the build time. What I mean by that is that when you remember that slide when I presented how to use Visual Studio versus GCC stuff, we specified release or debug not during configuration, but during later stages of CMake. And this is basically one of the most typical bugs we use. I've seen code like this: if CMake build type string equal debug, then do something, else do something. It will work for GCC and Clang, but will not work for Visual Studio because during configuration stage, you don't know if you have debug or release. For that, you should use those generator expressions. And you are doing this way, saying that if you are creating executable hello with source main, and now depending of the config debug flag, you are either link with debug or with release tools you use for your library. And this one is parsed during the build step, not during the configure step. I know that the syntax is maybe not the most friendly one, but this is how CMake works. I cannot do anything about this. But basically, this is how it should be done, and that's why generated expressions are really important to know when you are talking about installation stuff. Also, talking about the installation stuff, there is a thing called build interface and install interface. Those are the generator expressions filters used to provide something like this. Why? When you are building stuff, you want to find your headers in your subdirectory, include directory, yes, in the build tree. But when you install stuff somewhere and then delete the sources and then find package, you would like to use those header files that were installed to your user lib or user include directory somewhere, not from your source tree originally that were created there. And thanks to that, you can do it. This basically says that you have the, for library foo, you publicly use either those include directories if you are in a building phase, or you use this from the installation point of where you installed your thing. So that makes your library work and be possible to install and reuse by others. Here's an example of modern library example. You can see here that there are no user variables used. There is no set command here. And there are no commands that don't work on targets. And this is full-feature library. It's I implemented things like that many times, and you don't have to write anything else. So basically, you start every CMake with information which version is required. I recommend you installing the latest versions, up higher than 3.7 or 3.8 support C++ 17. And also, latest versions have better find module in CMake. Those are the special special files that look for gtests and boost and other stuff. They are being fixed all the time, so it's better to have newer version. Then you provide the project name, and you can provide the version for it. It's important for installation step because you then install with the specific version, and then you can find specific versions on the disk. And then you're using provide dependencies, like find package, some package foo, version 1.0, and it's a required dependency of my package. And then you define your own library, saying, this is my library. It's compiled from libs or CPP. And it compiles with features of C++ 17. Look, that it is provided for the target. And that it doesn't play with CXX flags at all. I just use a CMake to specify the version. I don't have to know how to specify this flag for GCC, Clang, ICC, Visual Studio, or other compilers you use. CMake already knows it. And moreover, it makes it transitive. So everyone that will use your target later on, this is a public tag. It means that it will be transitively passed to the others that are just linking with yours. Then you are using incl directories for your target. And you link with library foo that was found here. And at the end, you provide this alias that could be used later on with other CMake files that I will show you on the next slide. And please avoid any custom variables in your code. It's considered to be a bad practice right now. And basically, it's source of many, many problems and errors in CMake. And that's one of the reasons why we don't like CMake at all. Without it, it makes it life simpler, easier to understand, easier to work with. You don't have so many unexpected problems to handle. This is how you use the library. Basically, this is the, let's say these are the tests for my library. The beginning is really the same, so I'll not talk too much about this. You have to provide things like enabling testing, enable to see test to work, so you can do it. Then you find package gtest, module required, and here is how you use our library that we just created. If we don't have a target, my companion, my library, this is pretty important step. I will later on tell about this a bit more. So basically, if there is no target yet, we look for it with find package. Then we create our tests from test sources. We target link libraries for our tests. This time we are using this privately because it's just an executable. We take our library that we found or were created earlier somewhere, and with gtest mine. See that I never have to provide here the include directory of gtest. I never have to provide here the information that I'm linking with gtest, because this is only the main loop, the main function of gtest. I don't have to provide any of information about my library, that it's linked with foo, and where are my include directories on the disk. It just gets it automatically from the dependencies. This is how you write CMake right now, and how you should use CMake. This makes it much easier, much shorter. I'm talking about this refactoring of this project I said that I'm working on. I removed like 80% of CMake code from those files. 80% of code was not necessary. Just using the old style of using CMake. And with that, I have much less errors there too. And when I'm looking into the verbose log of building my project, actually, it fits on the screen like one comment. Later on, when I have 10 times boost and 50 times gtest and other stuff put into the inclad directory and linking stuff, it was really hard to see what the compiler is really doing, because everyone was adding this everywhere. And then you just do stuff like add test, unit test of our binary build here. This is basically how you use the library created in the other directory. Why I said about directory here? Because basically this is the file tree. I ended up with many experiments how to do it properly. Well, how I do is that I have a source that basically have all the sources for my project with CMake lists that's independent CMake, like the one you've seen, that you I can compile the project from this directory only. I don't have to go to the upper scope. This is independent, self-consistent CMake, and it just works. Here in the include directory, in my library, I put only the public headers of my library that is being installed on the disk and used by the client. If some of my implementation uses header files, I just pass them along with CPP files. It's easier for CMake to find them, and it clearly defines which of the headers are private for your project and which of them are public. In the directory that is here parallel to source, I have a test where I have those the other CMake that I show you that is importing this library and defining unit tests based on the test source CPP. And here, in the CMake list takes the, it's, I call it a wrapping CMake list. This is really simple, simple entry point for things like CLion or Visual Studio or your development CMake practice. In the CMake, you just have add subdirectory source, enable testing, add subdirectory test. This is for development. For development needs, you just use this CMake. It imports everything. So basically, you see here is this my company, my target created. And here we include this test. And we remember this branch. If my company, my target is already defined, I don't do anything. Otherwise, I'm using find package. That's why I had this branch there, because it's already defined by this. So with that approach, I can either work in a typical scenario we are used to. So I have my library being built and unit test being built, and it's tested every time I just compile my project. So typical development scenarios. Or when I enter the subdirectory of source, I can just compile the source of my library, install it to the disk. Then I go to the subdirectory of test, only compile the tests, and this test then required to find it on the disk where I installed it. So this one is then used also to test the installation of my project. So with such a file tree, I ended up with something that is really nice for development and also for testing our installation stuff. So the package. And I wanted to just share things from the Daniel Pfeiffer presentation, which things you shouldn't use in your CMake code. You should, if you have any definitions, like add definition, add compile options, include directories, link directories, link libraries, remove them. They shouldn't be there. This is not modern CMake. This makes your CMake really wrong, and you will have a lot of problems from that. Use target-specific things. Don't use file glob to find files. It's wrong. We had many problems with that. You should just specify file by file what you are using. It makes things much easier, and many ideas like CLion helps you with that. They just modifying the CMakes for you. Avoid unnecessary variables. As I said, with variables you have problem with spelling, for example. It's one of the problems only with them. There are many more. Keep your hands out of CXX flags. Use things like I show you, for example, defining standard library version. Do not put things like warning levels in CMake. This is a common mistake, basically. For example, let's assume that you specify that you want to build with W error and W all, of course, because it's a good practice, yes? And I'm taking your library after 5 years. I'm using C++ 23 right now. My compiler is much, much wiser, and it checks the standard much better. And I want just to compile my code with your code. And your code forces your library to compile with W all. And the compiler is much smarter. It finds thousands of errors in your library. I don't care because your code works. I don't want to play with it. I just want to use it. I cannot because your CMakes that you wanted to find and use for your development process to find all the bugs now affects me. I want only my bugs to be found, and I want to fix only my bugs, and I don't care about yours. Your library works, but the compilant found 10,000 warnings because something is the diagnostic is better. Don't force it on the developers. If you really want to have it automatically done, not provided externally from the CMake with some CMake CX6 flags during the configure step, you may do it, but do it only in this file. This is development file, not in this one, yes? This one is for your users. Don't force your users to compile with WOL or other flags you would like to have. If you need some specific flags, like, I don't know, preprocessor macros, like verbosity level, debug, or something, you can put it there, but still not with those. But there are target-specific stuff to do it, and don't play with CX6 flags directly. And also, don't use target include directories from path outside of your module. And don't use target link libraries without specifying if you mean private, public, or interface. Okay, so we compiled, built, tested. Are we done? No, don't be asocial, like David Sankel told some time ago on I think it was BoostCon. Asocial means that you are avoiding social interaction or inconsiderate or hostile to others. That's basically how we are when we are not providing installation for our project. When I'm working with dependencies, I often find that people are enough and they are really happy that the project compiled fine and they can use it. But if I would like to reuse your library, I don't know how to do it. You are the persons who know how to install it. You know exactly what headers are needed. You should provide me the means to install it in my system. So basically, we're right now talking about the installation of our project. This is how we install stuff. And this is the file tree I would like to achieve with later slides. It's a bit complicated, so bear with me. Basically, I would like to have it, this is a typical Linux-like installation, even on Windows, as you can see, that you can, if you remember, I provided the install prefix as a local in my home directory, so this is this one exactly. And then you have inklads with my library folder with all the public headers. It just copy-pasted from my source tree. And they have lib, CMake, and my library name here with all the CMake configuration files that clients will use for inclusion. And my library here, binary, that was built during the compilation step and linking. So basically, what we have to do to export our interface. This is a shorthand of the library we created. This was the big, longer file, but this are the most important stuff, yes? So we have some dependency foo, and we have our library, my library, version 0.1 here. So basically, what we have? We have to create, say, we want to install targets, and you provide which targets you would like to install. We have here only my library, so we are just working with my library here. And you say that you are exporting them to a target named my library targets. This is not yet a file, not a place on the disk. It's just say this is a list of targets I would like to export, and those targets listed here will be exported to those directories, like the binaries here and headers here and so on. Then, if you will gather all of the targets from your project in one place, you do install and export all of my targets on the list to this destination. And basically to this file. So basically it will create this file here, my library targets CMake. And it will put the targets here that you defined, my library will put in the namespace, my company. And this is where this find package gets the prefix then. And then I just copy all my public headers from inklad my library to the destination inklad. So I have this part already covered. And I have to create a config version file. There is a helper for it. And you just write basic package version file with this. And you say different compatibility styles. I would say same major version, but you can specify some others. And you say that, sorry. And that my config file and the file created here with this version should be just put into the libcmake my library. So we just created this file and this file here in this place. this one is created automatically by CMake, like probably doing this one. So we just created all the configuration files, put them in specific directory, and we just have to, this file was not created yet. So we are just creating it by hand, saying that we want to have one dependency foo version 1.0, and otherwise just include the file we created on the previous slide. There's a lot of boilerplate here, and I hate it. I asked Daniel Pfeiffer to help me with that, if it cannot be somehow made shorter, but as I know, it cannot be shorter, but it's pretty repetitive and trivial to do. I even did some helper function for me to help it with my project. But this is basically how you install your things in CMake. For doing testing, as I said, you are first going to the source build, then compile everything, install everything, and then you're going to test, build directory, you compile everything, and run tests with the version found by find package from the installation directory. However, CMake is not enough for us to cover everything. Is the dependencies done the wrong way? You have to download sources for each dependency. You have to compile them. You have to configure them. You have to install them each one by one. It's not easy, and it takes time. This is basically how we are using this right now, and this is the problem that we have to recompile everything. For example, when we update if we want to update gtest, then we have to compile everything that uses the gtest, and we have to find every element in our project that has 300 makefiles that use the gtest. It doesn't scale. Let's assume that we have many levels of dependencies, many configurations. And what about supporting different versions? You would like maybe to test on your disk installation and version of debug release with dep info. You would like to compile this with GCC, Clang, Visual Studio, and different version of libraries for Clang, for example, different runtime libraries from Visual Studio, or even package configurations, maybe version with exceptions, without exceptions, some shared lib, no shared lib, and so on. Try to think where you would install all of this into your file tree with CMake install. How you will handle the paths of all the binaries later on with find package to know exactly which version is debug, which one is release, which one is with Clang, which one is with GCC. It's really hard to store all of this in your file tree and then make find package work with that. What we want, basically, we want one build process that will build everything for us. Only the required dependencies will be rebuilt if something changes. No need to manually do anything. It should just download, compile, and configure stuff for us. And for example, if you would like to use your own zlib and boost or other libraries, you just downloaded the latest version. You don't want to have one from the user or system libraries that are from Ubuntu or something like this. And Conan tries to help with it. Conan is open source software with MIT license, is the decentralized package manager like Git, for example. It's also decentralized. This is similar architecture. Servers are not having any logic. They are just storing the data, the packages. All the logic is being done in a client. Clients can build from sources or use pre-built libraries. They are portable to any platform using Python, so basically to any OS right now, you can use it there. It works with any build system. I will scope mostly here on CMake, because as I said, CMake is somehow de facto standard in our environment, but you can use it with makefiles and others. It uses Python for its scripting language. It doesn't invent its own language for scripting. It just uses Python, which I think is a good choice. It's pretty easy to use. Basically, there are a bunch of servers you could use. There's a free Conan server that is on MIT license. You can just run it. It's fully functional, but it doesn't provide maybe some things like you may need for your corporate services, that's something that is reliable. In such a case, you can use JFrog Artifactory. What's interesting here that 2 weeks ago or week ago there was official release of this how it's called this this free edition for everyone of Artifactory that supports Conan and C++ basically. I don't remember exactly the name of this distribution right now. And JFrog Bintray is also open for every open source project you can use. Conan client is a console terminal application that does package creation and consumption. It has local cache, so you can work offline with it. Conan server, as I said, is a quite simple TCP server. JFrog Artifactory, as I said, the community edition of C++ was released 2 weeks ago. It's for free, so you have high quality server there. And JFrog is open for every open source software. So if you are doing open source, you can use just JFrog Bintray to work with it. Conan Center is an official repo there, moderated by the authors and by the team to make sure that the packages are of good quality, but there are also other repositories that you can use and find some packages there. There is Conan Community, Conan Bean Crafters, and others. Conan Package Identifier basically looks like this. You have package name, package version, user, and channel. Package name is basically the name of your project you are using. Package version, it can be any string. It doesn't have to be a number. It can be any identifier you use. User is basically used for that so that there can be official GTS from Conan, but basically if you don't like the official version, you can create your own. It will be known then by your own name, your specific package for GTS that does something differently maybe. Channel. It's for, let's say, stream of this package. It may, for example, mean, in most cases, it means just stable or testing, some maturity of a package, not the product. Because, for example, GTS is stable, but your package was created like 2 hours ago, and it's in a testing phase. It may not work correctly, yes? So you mean here that it's a testing or stable version of the package, not the product you are installing. And you can also use some other stuff, like if you want to do some tweaks for your project, you can just use the project name here to say this specific branch of package for my project. This is how the package looks on the server. Basically, it's the list of some directories. We have package, we have here different packages for different configurations. You can see that this is the configuration. This is information of the package, sorry, not the configuration. So basically, it's called GTS version 1.8.0, created by Bean Crafters, stable, and the information about the license, URL, and so on. And here are two pre-built versions. And this is so-called the recipe and some exports that are used for the package creation. This is how it looks on your file tree. It's in the user directory. And .conan data, you have exactly the same structure. And if you look into this package here, it just has the GTS installation. And see, if I need only release, I have only release even though there were two packages on the server. It downloads only that version that I need. If I ask for release version, I have the release version on my disk. If I will ask for something that is not on the disk, it will be compiled from sources. And you can upload this easily to the server, so you will not have to rebuild this any time soon, and just reuse it. To install the dependencies, you can either provide this identifier by hand, saying Conan install gtest and identifier, saying that you want to generate things for CMake in order to be built. But you can just say also Conan install dot dot and then special file created Conan file txt or Python file will be used to specify the dependencies of your project. You can also provide a profile that you would like to use, like I would like to install things, but for Visual Studio, not for my default compiler that may be GCC, for example, or MinGW on Windows. If there are some binaries missing, basically Conan will say you that you cannot use, that basically it cannot find the package for you, and it basically suggests you to compile it from sources. It will not compile it by itself. if you provide either build equals gtest or build missing for all the dependencies, it will just build it from sources. Conan file txt looks like this. It just have a requires group here saying what are your requirements of your project. Options, when you can provide some options for those, I would address this a bit later if we have time. And we have generators saying that we want to generate things for CMake. We want to generate for some other things, but I said CMake is a standard already and we should keep with CMake. CMake generator basically creates a Conan built info CMake file that defines some variables and some helper functions that you can use from later on to have better support. If you want to inspect dependencies and list the packages in the local cache, you use Conan search. If you would like to see specific details of specific package, you use Conan search and the name that was printed here on this list. If you want to inspect a project dependency of your current project, you can do Conan info on your project file. And there's a possibility to generate so-called binary metrics or table when you see what configurations are covered with binaries, which are not, or the graph of dependencies of your project. This is how the Conan info looks. When you talk, for example, ask for OpenSSL, what is the project information? You will get information about the ID of it, and what are the licenses, what are the remotes. But the most important part here is that OpenSSL currently is not required by anyone, but it requires zlib. If it requires zlib, it will download zlib, and it provides you what zlib provides and who requires zlib here. So basically, all the dependencies are transitive. If you want to download OpenSSL, it will automatically download the lib. If it needs to be rebuilt from sources, both of them will be rebuilt from sources automatically. Conan search, on the other hand, scopes mostly on the package details, so on this binary stuff. So it tells you how many packages you have for this gtest. I have only one. And which options, what is the configuration of it, basically? I would say that this ID here, it's probably some kind of CRC or hash of all of those options. So if anything changes here, like debug to release, there will be a new identifier here. So basically, this is the key to your associative, let's say, container looking for configuration files. If you change something here, the package ID will change. You will have to rebuild from sources. You can specify the architecture, build type, release or debug, compiler, if it's Visual Studio, GCC, Clang, or anything. What is the runtime of the compiler? What is the version of the compiler? What system, and so on. Options, for example, nearly all of the packages for Conan have an option shared. Then you can just say you would like to compile it with the shared library. It just uses this feature for CMake I introduced to you. And this is how you, in Conan file txt, use options introduced by this dependency. You can also override this from the command line, saying that you want to add option gtest shared equals true, or you can even provide that you would like all the dependencies compiled with shared equals true. If you're using shared libraries, probably you will find an error that it cannot find the binaries for you. So this is useful to add something like this in the import stuff to the file, saying that all the binaries should be put into the bin directory where you have your executables, and then it will be fine during the linking of dynamic linking of the application during run, during execute of it. Conan profiles. As I said, I have a profile for Visual Studio, so I just use the profile. I don't have to type all the information there. In the profile, I specify that I'm working on Windows 64. I'm using compiler Visual Studio, version 15, release 64 bits, and this is used for cross-compilation, if needed. You can override the some parts of the profile easily. You can say we are using the profile for Visual Studio, but I won't debug build, and then you are using the debug build easily. You can also provide such profiles in your file tree of your project and provide some more options for it, like which settings should be set and so on. I would not right now scope into it but, because we are a bit out of time. And also this is another case for the for the profile where you may define some, you can see that profiles can be included from one to each other. Using Conan with CMake, so the last part here that could be important is that I would like CMake to be transitive, so it may work with Conan or not. I don't want to yet to force my users to use Conan because it's not still a standard. So I'm using if here, so if the file generated by Conan is there, I'm using it, and I'm using Conan basic setup, so it creates targets for us of those dependencies. And all the rest of the CMake is not touched. This adds targets, as I said, it's a full support of Conan, and those targets are created like this, Conan package, colon, and gtest, for example. If you want just to find package to work and not have those targets, you can do things like Conan set find paths or even define that CMake module path that is used to be as a search path for find paths is one defined by Conan also, and the original one, of course, at the end. So it first will look for dependencies in Conan. Running both find package gtest and Conan basic setup targets gives us two types of targets. We have either the original one from find package and the one from Conan, which is not good, in my opinion. And which one to choose? It depends. In general, find package are more stable and they are here for many years, so they work better. But basically, it's really hard to make them properly address the transitivity. So if our dependency have other dependencies, it's really hard to make them work properly. It does not support multi-configuration easily for example, Visual Studio. If you want just to switch release and debug in the combo box in your IDE, find package will not work, will not know where to look for those. That's why we always create two directories, release and debug, and Visual Studio also does it when it's in CMake mode. However, it turns out that some issues with find package, for example, such an error for gtest, if you are using Visual Studio 2017 and gtest probably you've seen it, are patched already in Conan. So sometimes it's better to use Conan things. This is how they are fixed in Conan recipe file. I will not dip into details right now with that. And this is basically how you can, they have their own find gtest there that uses Conan compile definitions to work with that. You can look, if you are interested in the packaging of Conan, you can look how it's solved by bean crafters. It's pretty easy to follow in Python. We have, I'm really out of time. So you can use either that to choose the Conan. With CMake 3.11, it's possible to create such thing, like you will be able to alias or create a library for imported target. Okay, and another step is a huge one. This is Conan package creation that we don't have time for it today. As you can see, we are already out of time. So either refer to the Conan documentation because it's great, or wait for another lecture. I hope to present it on, for example, on CppCon or other conference, so we'll see. As a summary, CMake is already popular, but many projects still do not use it at all, or are using this in a wrong way, not a modern one, or even if they use the modern one, they're not doing the installation step, which is really important. Conan, it's already production quality, many companies use it. It's for free, with MIT license, servers are for you right now to use for free. It's quite easy to use. The docs are really good. Give it a try. And with that, thank you very much. Unfortunately, we don't have much time for questions. We have to leave time for other presenters to prepare. If you would like to have some questions, please ask me on the break or something.